بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Friends of the Dar, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. It is always a wonderful event for Dar al-Athar al-Islamiyya to receive one of many scholars who return to our lecture series through its 22 cultural season. Dr. Werner Daum, the former German ambassador to Kuwait and professor of Islamic history, is one such person. He not only has given a number of lectures here, including one in Arabic, he has also been a steady friend of the Dar. Dr. Daum has shared a wide variety of topics with our audience in our various venues, ranging from, for example, Kalila and Dimna and the Queen of Sheba. Egypt has always been thought of as the gift of the Nile. Tonight's lecture, however, entitled Egypt in Africa, goes much further back to examine how the antecedents of ancient Egypt developed linguistics, social, political, and religious systems during the period known as the Green Sahara. The climate then was much more humid than in our current period. As the climate became drier, Nilotic people such as the Dinka and the Nuer were forced eastward and southward. Dr. Daum comes well familiar with this area since he has been ambassador to several of these countries, particularly Sudan and Ethiopia, where he had on-the-ground access. Now, Dr. Daum is German. And I hear that the Germans have invented a system to block signals from telephones. He didn't bring a unit with him this time. So out of courtesy for Dr. Daum, let's do it ourselves. And let's welcome Dr. Werner Daum.
The rainy season had come to an end. The waters had receded. The hills were already dry. In between, the open water had disappeared. There were swamps, but the cattle could already be moved away from the cattle camp to the lush green meadows and vegetation which had grown in between. A new year was obviously on its way, which would bring blessings, which would bring an increase in the herds, which would bring marriages, and which would bring death for some. The Dinka leader contemplated the land before his eyes. He saw one of the hills where his own herd of cattle had been spending the rainy season. And all of a sudden, he felt that he had become old, that he had no longer the strength and the vigor of his more youthful days. He remembered that something like 20 seasons ago, as a young man, he had been gifted an oxen from his father, the preceding spear master of his tribe. He remembered how he had cared for this personal oxen, who symbolized much more for him than just an animal. How he had cared for his oxen, and how he had, over several months, deformed his one horn in a way which he felt was pleasing to himself, to his tribe, and to God. He prayed. He prayed silently to God, and he told him that he felt that his time had come. The next day, he summoned some of his people and told them that his time had come. They knew what they had to do and what he meant. Near his hut, they constructed a kind of subterranean chamber in the earth, about 2 to 3 meters large, about 3 meters deep. And when this chamber was finished, 2 or 3 days later, they put a bed and a sheet made from an ox hide into that chamber. And the old chief walked down on a ladder, which was then removed. They gave him a jar with milk and then roofed the chamber at the level of the earth. The old chief sat on his bed. The hole was roofed. It was covered with branches. The branches were covered with earth. And they knew that 2 or 3 or 4 days at the latest, he would have passed away. I will now come to another myth, to a myth, not another myth. This was the custom, what I have just told you. I will now come to one of the major myths of the Dinka people, how they imagined the creation of mankind. We have to say one thing before I'm going into the details, that in the Dinka belief, and generally in the belief of the Nilotic people, not only the Dinka, there is a sharp difference between what we call the human beings. There is the great majority of the human beings, and there is the political and spiritual and religious masters of the tribe, the so-called spear masters. Normal human beings so the Dinka believe, have been created by God, while the spear masters are the descendants of God who somehow came on earth, consorted with a human wife, and engendered the first spear master in human form. Every spear master knows, and his people know, that their leader has two natures, one human and the other one divine. The divine nature can only be transferred to the next generation of leaders if the spear master does not die a natural death. It can only be transferred to the next generation if his body is united in full shape and in full natural vigor with the earth. Only then can his divine immanence move on to the next leader. We have just heard how this was assured in the case of the Dinka leader. I've just said that the basic distinction among the Dinka is between those who have been created by God, the normal human beings, and the leaders who are the direct descendants of God. God, after having created the humans, came on earth and instituted rulership and the preservation of the religious knowledge. How did God create the human beings? I have been asking this a considerable number of Dinka priest chiefs, but the answer was always rather general. Why do you want to know how he created them? God is overpowerful. He can do what he wants. He created them because he wanted them to create. Of course, did he create them in heaven? But how this was done? Then some people, you can imagine, Africa, you can never talk with one person all alone. There will always be a gathering around you. So some people from the audience said, oh, well, he made them from tin, from our nation, our means of communication was Arabic. He made them from clay, which of course was not the Dinka tradition, but the influence of either Christian education or Muslim, the Muslim faith or Islam. The knowledgeable Dinka priests simply stuck to the fact that God created them because God wanted to create them. How did Earth look at the time? Earth was flat, but covered with an immense expanse of water. This water was called Adek Tiet. Adek means tirer, the one who is tiring somebody else, and Tiet is the plural of bird, the tirer of the birds. Though this water was called the Tyre of birds because it was so wide and so large that birds, that no bird could fly over it. They would die before they would reach the other end. In the center of this enormous expanse of water, there was a slight elevation, not a real hill, but a slight elevation, swampy, wet, with water all around it, but still something different from the watery environment in which it was situated. And in the middle of this elevation, there grew an enormous tree, a chwai tree, Tamarindus indicus. And God dropped the first two human beings, a man called Garan and a woman called Abuk. He dropped them at the edge of this elevation. And they walked towards the tree, and they sat under that tree. The heaven was just above that tree, maybe 20, 25 meters above the watery expanse. So Garan and Abuk, the first human couple, sat under that tree, and they begat children, and their children begat other children, and they multiplied. They did not have to care for their life. Everything what they needed fell down from the tree. Dhurra, millet, sometimes other things, sometimes a gourd filled with milk. So they had everything what they wanted and what they needed. They never got sick. There was no sickness. And they didn't die. Death had not yet come. And they multiplied and multiplied. And at the beginning they were happy. But then after so many generations, after God had come on earth and created or engendered the first spare master leader, this first leader came to that elevation in the middle of the watery expanse and told the humans that life could not go on like that. With superhuman strength, he chased heaven above and he led the human beings away from that place through the watery expanse to its shores. They didn't wish to cross, but he forced them to cross into the world as we know it today. This world is characterized by illnesses, by death, by hunger, but it has one thing which they did not have before. It has light, it has the sun. Paradise, therefore, in the Dinka and to a large extent the mythology of other Nilotic people, paradise is totally different from our Christian or Muslim paradise. It is not a blessed space. It is a space where material things are provided, but where the greatest spiritual enlightenment of our existence, light and sun, are inexistent. This, in my view, proves, together with the fact that there is no such thing as a creation out of clay or earth, that the Dinka mythology is totally independent from our Jewish or Christian or Muslim tradition. I will now speak very briefly about two phenomena of the level of the earliest stratum of the ancient Egyptian religion. When we think about ancient Egypt, we think about pyramids, we think about pharaohs, and we think about mummies. All three of them are not there at the beginning of Egyptian history. The pyramids began in the fourth dynasty. Mummification, as we know it, much, much later. And the figure, the splendor of Pharaoh is also to be dated at a later period. What we know from the earliest Egyptian intellectual and religious world, which is identical, is first the creation story. The creation story in Egypt, again, is a story about how in a vast watery expanse which covered the earth, a so-called hill, creation hill, emerged in the center. In ancient Egyptian, it was called Benben. We remember the Dinka parallel. The other thing is how or who was Pharaoh? Pharaoh, in the Egyptian belief, until the very end of the Egyptian civilization, had two natures. A human nature and a divine nature. The human nature was obvious. Pharaoh looked like a human being. The divine nature was explained from the earliest times onwards through the following myth that a god, divinity, took the disguise of the wife of the current pharaoh, approached the wife of the current pharaoh, and engendered the new pharaoh, the soon-to-be-born son of the royal couple. In order to preserve the divine nature of Pharaoh, he would not be allowed to be buried the way human beings would be buried. In fact, those of you who have been to the British Museum in London will remember the most gruesome exhibit there, a prehistoric tomb of the late 5th or early 4th millennium, which shows you a skeleton somehow with its skin preserved through the dry climate of Egypt, but buried in a pit in the sand without any structure around it. So Pharaoh could not be buried that way. Pharaoh was buried at the very, very beginning of the Egyptian history, before the first dynasty. Pharaoh was buried in the then capital of Egypt, in Upper Egypt, in Hierakonpolis, in a pit which was built in the earth, a subterranean chamber which was covered with a layer of earth. Pharaoh was buried there after he had died naturally, but it seemed important that his body should enter this subterranean room intact. This is, I think we can say that with confidence, the beginning of the idea of mummification. The body should not decompose. The body should be preserved in order that the divine nature would move to where it belonged to. I will now come to climate change. Climate change is not a contemporary event. Climate change has happened ever since the Earth has existed. We are today quite well informed about the various changes which took place in the last several hundred thousand years, and in particular the most recent events during the Holocene and the early prehistory of our time. Until about 8500 BC, or roughly 10,000 years before today, the Sahara was hyper-arid, even more arid than today, which is it is difficult to believe. The Sahara was absolutely hyper-arid and much larger also than today. Around 8500 BC, this is the map here on the left, all of a sudden, within a geologically and climatologically extremely short period of maybe 100 years, all this changed. The reason is not well established, but we know from very recent research, and I would guess that it would be impossible for you to find this already in handbooks in the libraries. All this, what I'm going to tell you now, is research of the last 30 years. Around 8500 BC, a fundamental change occurred in the Eastern Sahara, and as Sheikh Ahusa has observed this morning when we talked about it, also, of course, on the Arabian Peninsula. But I'm not talking about the Arabian Peninsula. Before 8500, you can see human occupation only here on the border between Sudan and Egypt, and two or three minor settlements in Egypt. The Sahara is empty from human occupation. Then, with the onset of the humid period, the savanna and the green belt of Central Africa moved northward for about 800 kilometers within an extremely short period. So here, this is all still desert, no human occupation. And then around 8,500, the rains move northwards and the vegetation follows immediately. What also follows is large animals and animals in general. Elephants, rhinos have been found in southern Egypt and of course in the Sudan desert. Giraffes, zebras, the whole fauna of Africa. And of course, human beings as well. So, and at the same time, with the onset of the rains, here and of course in Ethiopia, the Nile also changed its regime. The Nile, which at that time had been roughly what it is today, became a wild, torrential, enormous stream. So torrential that it did no longer allow human beings to live on its shores. But why would they despair? No reason for that. The Sahara had become green, so they moved into the Sahara. They invented, possibly independently from Mesopotamia, pottery. Around 6000 BC, they started domesticating our ox and cultivating cattle. And the Sahara was now not only wet, not only teeming with animals, it had large rivers, enormous paleo lakes, some of them much bigger than Lake Chad today, and a human population of hunter-gatherers moving around in that whole region, moving around with their cattle and sheep and goat, which these were imported from Mesopotamia and not domesticated locally. So we can speak of one cultural area of people intermingling among themselves in that whole region of the desert of northern Sudan and the southern half of Egypt. The few dots up there on top should not be considered by us. They are somehow influenced from the Mediterranean climate. So let me repeat what I just said, my last sentence. These were not settled populations. There must have been an intermingling of people, of languages, of beliefs, of cultural identities, with at the same time a differentiation among these groups and this enormous area of, well, 3 or 4 million square kilometers. Then, after a while, the climate became more arid again. People, the green belt moved southward. Lakes dried up. There were still enough and some rivers, but much less than in that period. And human beings gathered around these sources of water. We must imagine at that time that this more or less homogeneous group differentiated itself. Around 3,500, the humid period came to an end. We can now see that the people who had been living in the desert with a few remains in where some paleo lakes were still filled with water, that the people had moved. We do not see it on this map, but on the next one, people had moved from the desert southward, southeast, southwest, and in considerable numbers towards the Nile. For the first time, we now have a population along the Nile. Clearly, this population was so dense and it was settled because people now on their livelihood depended also on fishing and on some form of agriculture. It was so densely settled that naturally a stratification of the society occurred and political rule was instituted. The desiccation of the eastern desert continued until around 1500 BC. Roughly, the climate resembled the climate we have today. You see very few remains of human settlement, and you see painted in red here were now the major population of the region concentrated itself. After 1500 BC to this day, this is the picture which we all know. There is only one paleo lake remaining in this eastern Sahara. This is Unyanga Kabir in Chad. This is very salty, and it is fed by subterranean water through an aquifer constituted at the time of the Green Sahara. The evaporation of this rather small lake is so enormous, it corresponds to the consumption of water of a European town of 1 million inhabitants per day. We have to imagine, however, that this was the kind of Sahara at the time of the Green Sahara. Oh, yes. I come back to what I said. Here on this map, you can see superimposed the present-day vegetation limits and in the inset how it looked during the time of the Green Sahara. Now we come to the third point of my talk, languages. For the climate change, I relied on the work of the Cologne Acacia project, the biggest scientific project in the humanities ever done in Africa, which started in the late 1970s, which encompassed over 200 researchers, and which revolutionized our understanding of the climate of Africa, not only of the Sahara, but also of southern Africa. For the language discussion, which I'm now presenting to you, I'm relying on equally the most current research, which is also centered at the University of Cologne in Germany. This should come after it. No. Yeah. This will be more or less familiar to you. Here in white, this is the Sahara Desert, and therefore no people there and no languages spoken. This line is Semitic, here in Ethiopia as well. The peninsula, Kuwait, you will recognize there. This is a map of the so-called Afro-Asiatic Phylon, the Afro-Asiatic language group, which is the African language group paralleled to Indo-European or Indo-Germanic. And you see the six contemporary accepted subgroups of Afro-Asiatic. Today, the most important one being Semitic, then Old or Ancient Egyptian, Chadic here in the center, Berber in the habitable parts in northern and western Africa, Cushitic in most of Ethiopia, and Omotic also in a part of Ethiopia. Here you have to imagine, of course, that Semitic is over there, the Arabian Peninsula. It's not on the map. Here you have the other highly important language group, which is of concern to us today. This is, you have in red, Afro-Asiatic in Africa, and Eastern Sudanic, which is the yellow. Eastern Sudanic, here it says Nilo-Saharan. I will not go into definitions. This is a question dear to linguists. Let us call the yellow thing Eastern Saharan language group, a very large language group which encompasses about 40 languages today, from central Sudan and Chad to Tanganyika in the south and Kenya, most importantly Nilotic peoples such as the Dinka or the Nuer or the Shilluk, but also Maasai in Kenya, Karamojong in Uganda, etc. This is a more reduced map which shows the main individual Nilo-Saharan, or rather Eastern Sudanic languages, which encompass up there the Nubian language, which encompass here in this kind of red the Nilotic languages, the largest group. The Dinka would be here. In Ethiopia, Nara. In the west, Fur in Darfur. Berta in the west of Sudan, etc., etc. What you can see here is, combined with other phenomena which I'm not going to go into details, you are seeing a river called Wadi Hawar up there. Yeah? Can you see it? Wadi Hawar today only exists in its upper course, but during the Green Sahara, it was a stream, a mighty stream in power comparable to the Nile, and it has dried up completely. So the lower part of the Wadi Hawar today is not even recognizable in the field. But you can see, and if linguistic criteria are applied to all these languages and their differences compared with what must have been the original Eastern Sudanic language, you will see that all these originated in the region of Wadi Hawa. So the people of that region moved away when it became dry. Some moved to the Nile, the Nubian speakers, or in history, the Meroitic speakers. Some moved west, some moved southwest, and a very large group moved southward. We have thus here the origin of two of the world's major language groups, Afro-Asiatic, including Semitic, and Nilo-Saharan, in extremely close contact and probably within the same region, of people moving around freely and therefore, of course, sharing not only linguistic communalities, but also beliefs, religion, traditions, in short, their intellectual worldview. Egyptian is Egyptian, a separate unit within Afro-Asiatic. Some scholars believe that Egyptian, ancient Egyptian, of course, and Coptic are part of Semitic. We will not discuss this today. There has been a lot of speculation about the origin of Semitic. And we are today back at the very beginning of the scholarly discussion when Guidi, in the middle of the 19th century, an Italian scholar, postulated from the vocabulary of Semitic, postulated that it was not born in a mountainous region, neither in Yemen nor further north, but that it was born in a flat country with rivers. This bears wonderful comparison with what I have been telling you. So we have to imagine that, of course, the origin of Afro-Asiatic is here in the Eastern Saharan Desert, the northern part of Sudan, and the southern part of ancient Egypt. These people differentiated themselves into two language groups, the Nilo-Saharan, which remained and moved further south, and the future Afro-Asiatic, including Egyptian, and proof that it originated here is this large chunk of Ethiopia, except for the Semitic Gurage, etc., and of course, Ges in northern Ethiopia. This large chunk clearly explains that the origin of Afro-Asiatic was here, and that it moved west, north, along the Nile into Egypt, and then into what is today the heartland of the Semitic-speaking world. Not only did those two language groups originate here, but we have to assume that the beliefs, the religion, the intellectual world, the worldview, which we can still observe in some places, such as among the Dinka, where the material environment today is still identical with what it used to be during the Green Sahara period. We have to imagine that this intellectual world put its stamp, not only where it was preserved, but also on the Egyptian religion, the divine human nature of Pharaoh, the need for him to be mummified and buried in a particular way, and the creation story of the ancient Egyptians. Thank you so much.